Hello and welcome to the February 2023 edition of The Watch Club, brought to you by the Newburyport Documentary Film Festival. I am Program Director James Sullivan, and today we are happy to have with us the director of The Subtle Art of Not Giving a Fuck. And quick warning, we might be saying the word fuck a few times. That would be because the subject of this film, Mark Manson, says it all the time. So for those of you who are immediately offended by my usage of the four-letter words, you'll see in the film, if you haven't already watched it, that it's pretty prevalent in the film. Nathan Price is the director of the film, which is based on Mark Manson's number one New York Times best-selling self-help book, which we'll learn more about in a minute if you haven't already watched the film. For those of you who haven't, let's take a quick look at the trailer and then we'll be back on with director Nathan Price.
You're going to die one day. I just wanted to remind you.
Stand clear.
This is me, Mark Manson, and I wrote a book. It's about self-esteem. You deserve to be special and unique and extraordinary. Actually, that's bullshit.
We'll be singing when we're winning. We'll be singing.
It's about positivity. You go on social media and you feel like a loser. The message is that a better life is about more, more, more. Making a lot of money might make you feel good, but it won't make your kids love you.
Ah!
Our brain is kind of playing this game with us. To give a fuck about everything, a nicer job, low-fat milk, SPF and ozone, social media. Who's the CEO? Is this a riot or a fucking parade? Then we'll live happily ever after. There's only a few things in life that are ever worth giving a fuck about. It'd be a hell of a lot easier if I could just hit you with six easy steps to life success. But to really get into this stuff, you've got to feel it. And to feel it, I guess I'm going to have to dig up some old painful shit.
Watch Club members, please welcome director Nathan Price. Hi, Nathan.
James. Good to see you, sir.
You are based in New Zealand, correct?
Auckland, New Zealand. That's where I am. Yeah.
Right. So this is such a fun film about such a sort of, you know, not necessarily always fun topic, as we see, you know, asking yourself hard questions, right? So
yeah,
we have a local to our town, Newburyport, fan of the shows who watches all the time. And she emailed me today to say, I can't watch this one. Something came up, but I did already watch the film. And she said, I really needed this film, you know, which I think is true for a lot of people. You know, she said, I didn't know it, but I really needed this film. And I really needed to think about some of the ideas that Mark has in his book and now in this film. So before we get into the, content of the film, why don't you tell us, if you don't mind, Nathan, a little bit about your own background in filmmaking and how it came to be. I think Mark's based in Austin, Texas, right?
He is in LA now. He was in New York at the time that the project was coming together, but he came down here to do the actual interview. So
came out to where you are, to New Zealand. Right. Okay. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about your background in filmmaking and how you met Mark and decided to work on this project together.
For sure. I guess it's a little unique. I'm not a sort of a uniquely documentary director. I'm advertising's my bread and butter. So I've been I make TV commercials around the world. That's my usual jam. And I've made a few TV dramas here in New Zealand. I made some docos back in film school days. But I was sort of approached by Matthew Metcalf, who is sort of a prolific documentary producer here in New Zealand. And Universal, they were looking for someone to take on because they sort of, they got, they'd sort of done the deal with, with Mark, and they were trying to figure out how to make it. And so they were really interested in finding someone who wasn't necessarily from the traditional documentary mm-hmm. world, because they wanted it to have a certain sort of scale. And I think they also knew it was a difficult genre to tackle. And it needed to, you can't really think of it like the question is it even a documentary? I mean, or is it more of some sort of video essay? I mean, self-help is sort of notoriously difficult to translate into film. So I think they wanted someone who had the, maybe some different skill sets that could bring that to life. So they approached me about that. We sort of pitched ideas. They had a sort of a basic treatment of it, and then I sort of pitched them ideas back, and they were excited about that. So we moved from there, and then we met Mark when he came down. I talked to him a little bit beforehand, but he came down here because it was COVID times, and he really wanted to come, and it was way more convenient. And we were still open for business in New Zealand because we had we didn't have the same lockdowns you had in the States.
Right. Yeah, so that's why I wanted to start about it, talking about how you discussed with Mark how to make this film. It struck me throughout watching it how difficult it must have been, but what you came up with really it pops. You know, there's so much fun stuff in it, and so much, whether it's archival content like that, or the staged stuff that you did with. Actors and costuming and, there's a lot of the stuff to me felt very surreal. On purpose, I would imagine. Right. But so can you talk a little bit about how those conversations went? Like, how do we keep this from just being Mark as we're looking at right now, as a talking head on screen, and liven up his ideas with some of this other content that, like I said, really pops in your film?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's inherently tricky. Yeah, I mean, my first step, obviously, when you're doing something like this, is to look for previous genre things that you can kind of draw on. And there just wasn't really anything. No, right. I mean, there's a few kind of, you've got your Anthony Robbins kind of concert film kind of, Brené Brown, and they're all kind of like town hall style kind of. And that didn't feel right, I mean, our big concern was, why is this sold 20 million copies? It's because his voice has really reached people. So how can we create something, and that was what was driving the creativity to start with, is like, how can I translate this voice into some sort of visual medium?
Right.
And then you have this issue of like, well, what is the story? Is there a story? And if so, so I had that question. My question was like, well, who is the main character in a kind of a self-help book? And the conclusion I drew was that, well, you are the reader, you're the one who's sort of testing yourself,
mm-hmm.
that, and you're kind of like the one who's come to the book, usually with a problem or something not feeling right. Mm-hmm. And in this case, come to the film. And then that sort of mirrored. And so then the question was, well, how do you create this kind of character where the viewer is somehow, and it's happening, it's not happening necessarily on an outside you dramatic level. It's sort of phenomenological in the sense that you're dealing with your own kind of relationship to the world.
Yeah.
So then the question is, well, how do you create, how do you sort of illustrate these psychological states, and how do you try to create a sense of a character that kind of travels through? And so we had a couple of ideas of that. One, of course, there's a biographical aspect, which is, Mark's story. And that sort of mirrors, a broader character story. And then we sort of have to have these other characters that kind of are proxies for you and your own psychological state. And then we tried to do that with Stock, partly in characters and his stories and sort of surreal elements. The music was also a really big part of it, just making sure we kind of felt the emotion changing so that you had a chance to feel it as you're going through. I can hear a little bit of that voice coming through, actually. So that it was tricky. What else was I gonna
say? I would think that you I could see you saying, I think I've decided that this film is not about Mark. It's about the viewer.
Yeah.
And I could see him going like, that's it. You know, like, that's exactly right. That's what this should be. Right. Because it is about, you know, self-help, and the person who watches it is going to be thinking, how does this relate to me? Right.
Yeah, of course. Well, I mean, there's two characters, right? Because I think there's Mark, his younger sure. self, which is right. more of a kind of a proxy for you, you know, the struggling. And then there is the kind of the older Mark who yep. can speak with a little bit of wisdom about it. I think part of the point of the film is you never really totally crack these things. Living is a notoriously difficult task and living well. But we sort of, you know, we try to approach the mark. But I think the great thing that his story actually, you know, gives you kind of like specific structural beats that you can kind of lock into. But then it was really important, I think, that we broadened that feeling out, that it was almost monomythic, you know, that we all have a kind of a similar struggle. You know, we all struggle with suffering. We all struggle with our own bad behavior that sometimes results from our response to our suffering. And then we all kind of have to figure our way out of the holes we get ourselves into by the kind of the way we paint the world to kind of protect right. ourselves.
I should say that to anyone watching live, if you want to ask Nathan a direct question yourself, all you got to do is type it into the comments section on YouTube, and we will take a look at it and pose it to Nathan directly. So Nathan, can you describe for me and for us, you know, you were talking about Mark's voice, which is distinct. Obviously, it's why his book did so well.
Yeah.
He has an irreverent approach, I think is safe to say, to this whole idea of self-help.
Yeah.
For which he's got plenty of predecessors, you know, tons of, you know, very popular books that came before him. Can you describe what makes his own voice unique in this realm of self-help?
What makes it unique? I mean,
this worldview will fall apart.
It's, I think there's a sort of a brutal honesty, and there's also a kind of a, it seems to me, I think Mark's not saying anything particularly new, and he'll say this himself, right. You know, this is the Stoics. This is what Buddha was coming up with.
Yeah.
This is what, the existentialists were talking about.
Yeah.
It's kind of old knowledge, mm-hmm. but I think what he manages to do is speak to you in a way that feels down to earth, that feels like he's been there, that's someone speaking from the trenches. You know, somebody, one of the things I read when we were researching the film was that, you know, people feel like he's a friend of yours in a bar who's telling you, you know, telling you the truth, you know, laying it down. And you kind of have that trust for him because he has that familiarity. He's not like, I mean, Anthony Robbins, great, but he's square jaw. He's like, I don't know, 100 feet tall, and he lives in Fiji in a mansion or whatever. It's a little harder to relate to. And I think he just has this great kind of like stoic kind of fun way of telling you stuff. He's like a buddy you'd trust. But he's smart, you know. He's got a way of kind of taking those things and spinning them around and also putting them into the context of today's culture.
Yes.
You know, and I think part of it also was just his publishers and that finding the voice that he had done a blog for, and he had a million followers before they got him to do the book. So he had already kind of managed to hone that voice of a way that he could, you know, speak to people. And another thing interesting I found out about him in the process was each weekend he actually kind of individually replies to a certain number of his fans who are writing in with problems.
Right.
You know, a lot of them, his assistant can just say, oh, read this article, this guy. But he takes, you know, 20 or so of them each weekend and takes time to write back. And that's a way he kind of continues to evolve that voice. So there's a real kind of care about how he's created this ability to communicate and the way he says stuff. And I guess he just keeps testing it. You know, he just keeps testing, like, oh, does this get through? Oh, no, people don't really get that. Okay, what about this? What about this? But still that thing of a buddy, but someone who's really crafting it as well. You know, he loves writing. He loves sort of getting those kind of finding the right way to kind of to get that information through to you in a way that you can kind of understand. It doesn't feel too hoity-toity, or, you know, doesn't alienate you by being pretentious.
Well, exactly. And you mentioned, the Buddha and the existentialists, yeah. All of which, you know, the Stoics, you know, all of that does, you know, kind of underlie what Mark's talking about, but he doesn't reference any of that stuff. Mm. You know, a couple of times I was thinking, oh, that's Zen, right? Like what he's talking about, but
yeah,
he definitely is talking in the language of 2023, right? I mean, it's way more about social media than, you know, there's no real references that I recall to philosophers or sort of like weighing the whole thing down by showing how smart he is about the subject, right?
Yeah. And that was a kind of a conscious choice as well. I mean, there is more of that in the book about sort of, I mean, there is a specific story of the Buddha, but it didn't, they were too kind of wordy to work in the cinematic space. I felt like it felt to me that we had to be the emotional version of the book, you know, that like you had to have some emotional arc where you could feel a character kind of moving through it. And in that way, it's a lot more, it's a lot more of a felt experience, I think, that we were creating here.
In the course of writing all these years, I always...
That was sort of different because when I did the interview, you know, they were very long interviews and we had, you know, very long and wordy parts. And then when in the editing stage, it's like, it's not boring. You know, he can't talk too long. You have to kind of get to a problem emotionally and then he can speak to that problem. And then you kind of move on to the next problem. Mm-hmm. And so there has to, it still needs to kind of work in a more narrative way.
Where is that space that you're used for him? I mean, if he was in New Zealand, you just found a space for him to use, right? As a buddy's, funky apartment or something. What is that?
It's actually an old mental institution.
Oh, Jesus, really?
But we dressed it. Yeah, and it was, I mean, the question is, I mean, I was sort of influenced a bit by, you know, Errol Morris's big, you know, because it's a single subject and a single interview kind of thing. So it needs to be kind of interesting enough space to kind of hold you for that amount of time. So we kind of constructed that in that environment. And it was partly just to kind of be cues of a bar, you know, that idea that you are sitting with someone, that it could be, you know, this sort of slightly liminal space where, you know, you might be feeling these things. That was kind of the inspiration there.
Right. What would you say you personally learned? I mean, I'm sure you spent time with Mark's book before you started filming and, you know, I have no idea. Maybe you if you care to tell me, like, to what extent, if any, you have personal experience with, you know, sort of like seeking answers through books, whether they're self-help or otherwise. And is there anything in particular that you learned from having these extensive conversations with Mark that you've continued to go back to and recall and feel like, oh, wow, like that was powerful in an unexpected way?
Yeah, I think it did. I mean, I do think it changed me, actually. I mean, when I read the book, I mean, yeah, I'm pretty well read. I've, you know, and I read all the self-help books in my 20s, you know, the Seven Habits of This and the, you know, the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance and, you know,
name
it. You know, it's, and I do love it. You know, I love philosophy and I love reading and engaging in that stuff. I'm a huge fan of the Tao Te Ching. I hadn't actually engaged in the Buddhist that much in Buddhism. So that was good because I'd sort of written it off a little bit. How did it change me? You know, when I first read the book, I was a little bit like, you know, I'm a 48-year-old man. I'm like, I read it and I'm like, oh yeah, I know most of this stuff. You know, I've come across it before. But what I was really taken by was his voice, you know, like he's made it really fun and that's what sort of really drew me to the project.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I think you can say, this is my observation is, you know, when I read the Tao Te Ching, say, I was like, oh man, this is so genius. This is so wise. Surely now humanity will have sorted itself out because, you know, it had all this wisdom. And, you know, it's always a little bit disheartening because you're like, wow, they knew this stuff, you know, 3,000 years ago. How come we haven't sorted their shit out as humanity? and you realize it's just, you know, human beings, we have these amazing brains, you know, every one of us, you know, the smartest guy, the you know, the least smart guy, we have these amazing minds. And you may not feel like you're doing that well, but we do. They're Ferraris. They're just really hard to drive. and it's really easy to be a dick. And it's really easy to get caught up in your own shit. And it's really easy to get disheartened or caught or, you know, or too anxious about stuff. It's a complicated world. And our brains are amazing, amazing things. And I guess my observation coming to it was, yeah, I thought I knew this stuff. But you never really do, you know? Like you kind of you kind of just have to kind of keep coming back to it. And that there's something really edifying about me having that opportunity just to really engage in the material and think about how I could communicate it to other people. And, you know, when you do that, you actually, you kind of have to take it on a bit yourself. So I think, I've come out of it, you know, I'm a lot more engaged in mindfulness and trying to think about things. I don't know. I think it's one of those subjects, like, you know, there has been a little bit of criticism, from the critics of, and particularly film critic people, they're really well read and stuff, and they're like, you know, it's pretty basic, you know,
right?
And it's like, it is, but I also think that getting the basics right is the hardest thing that anyone can ever do.
And to go back to your Ferrari analogy, maybe, you know, some of us think we know some of this stuff, but you need to constantly be tuning up, right?
There's knowing it and there's practicing knowing it, you know, in the Tao, they say the way you can go is not the real way. It's, you can never actually kind of approach that perfect path. So any effort you can make to kind of bring yourself back to kind of a path that is, close, you know, that I think that's a healthy thing, you know, and I guess partly I think for those people who maybe are more familiar with the material already, I'm like, well, just think of it as kind of like a hyper dramatized meditation session. You know, you know, you're gonna pay like a certain amount for headspace for a guy going, oh yeah, man, just let your mind wander. And so maybe this is like a sort of a more visual version of that. You know, I don't think you can know this stuff too well. You know, I really don't. I mean, the Dalai Lama. He apparently, he says, people are like, how are you this amazing? How are you this kind? And he's like, I have to meditate for 4 hours a day to be this good. It's basically, otherwise, you know, I'd probably just be an asshole, you know? I actually had this yoga instructor in Rishikesh one time, and he was telling about his guru, and he said he was this amazing man. He was this amazing man, and he was so, you know, yogaed out, he got to the end of his life, he just turned into a real jerk for his last couple of years.
Really?
So, you know, we can always just slip away from our ideal self.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know.
What can you say? So one thing that struck me is that, Mark's, presence and his voice, as you said, is definitely very dude-ish, right?
Yeah.
I'm curious,